Good morning. Good morning to everyone who is here and everyone who is watching from home. This is the fourth Sunday of Easter and Trinity Episcopal Church in Bloomington, Indiana. We thank you for being here this morning to give praise and glory to God. Please stand as you are able for the processional hymn. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls each of us by name and follow where he leads, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from Acts. The rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem, with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm will be read responsively by half verse. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He revives my soul. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me.
You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Reading from 1 John. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother and sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth, and we will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. The word of the Lord.
Please stand as you are able for the gospel.
Oh, Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down for my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I received this command from my Father." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. There is a lot of exclusivity in the Gospel of John and in other parts of the New Testament. By this I mean there are a lot of claims that it is only through Jesus or through faith in Jesus or being a member of the Church of Jesus, being a Christian, it's only through that you are saved or righteous in right relationship with God. Our readings from Acts and the Gospel of John today both contain this type of language. There is salvation in no one else than Jesus, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved, says Peter. There will be one flock, one shepherd, meaning Jesus, says Jesus in the Gospel of John. This Gospel in particular, John, is full of this type of language and has been used by some to argue that only Christians will get into heaven. All the other faithful of the world, Hindus, Muslims, Jews, Native Americans who practice their own religions, etc., they won't go to heaven, they say. These claims are a bit difficult to support in our modern era. We know many Christians who fervently believe their salvation is Jesus and who also behave in ways that kind of make us wish they wouldn't get into heaven. We also know that there's a huge diversity of religions and ideas and beliefs about God or gods. And many people who don't believe in Jesus seem like perfectly good people. And it's hard to imagine them being rejected by God in any way. And these claims are even more worrisome given the divides that we already have in this society. We can't agree on so many things: how to combat racism, gun regulation, whether we should allow plexes in our neighborhoods here in Bloomington. We have vicious name-calling fights over these issues. Adding religion into these fights, making it another source of division, adding claims that ours is the only true faith will make things worse. I actually believe Christian communities should be engines of social healing and reconciliation, not sources of division. Nonetheless, we hear a lot of exclusive language in our scripture, and we don't get to ignore it. We have to take it seriously. Because A, we take scripture seriously. And B, if we ignore it, we leave it to the Christians who want to use it to divide and exclude and condemn people, and they get to do the interpreting. So how can we deal with this aspect of scripture and our faith? We, all meaning all of us sitting here, we wouldn't be here if we hadn't come to know in our hearts that Jesus is God, that Jesus shows us the way to God,
and that following Jesus has given us joy and life and meaning and hope. How do we reconcile this with people whose faith tell them there are other ways? There are actually a variety of theological approaches. One is just simply exclusive, extra ecclesia nulla salus, no salvation outside the church. I knew a few people were going to get that right away. Actually, that concept is from our Roman brothers and sisters, and so strictly speaking, under that rule, we Episcopalians are outside the church and not saved. And this belief is really hard to reconcile with the goodness of non-Christians, our sense of a loving God who does not reject or exclude, and the joy of a faith that seems incompatible with exclusion. Another approach by the theologian Karl Rahner is to claim that the world is full of, and these are his words, anonymous Christians. What he means by that is people who aren't specifically Christian, but who live in a way that exemplifies Christian values, and therefore they are in some sense inside the church and saved, whether they know it or not, or whether they care about it. It's actually not a bad idea, but it's a bit problematic. The anthropologist in me thinks that it doesn't take the beliefs of others seriously enough. They really are different, and it subsumes them under our beliefs in a way that treats theirs as less important, less substantial. Another approach is to start from experience, to make your argument from reason and experience, and the experience that there are many beliefs about God and that many good people hold them, and then argue that there are many paths to God and ours is just one of them. I might even add to this that we could look around our diverse world, which is diverse biologically and it's diverse culturally, and conclude that God might, in fact, like diversity, including religious diversity. That's not a bad way of looking at it either, and I actually go that route a lot. But there is a problem with this, in that it does sort of ignore the importance that we place on Jesus. And it ignores all that stuff in the scripture that tells us how important Jesus is, and it can lead us to downplay the true joy that comes from the good news of the resurrected Christ, who was and is to come, who conquered death, who is God and therefore reveals God in a direct way to those who believe in him. And those are wonderful things, not to be cast aside casually. And there are a whole bunch of other choices and approaches, and I'll just stop now so that we have a reasonable Episcopalian-length sermon. And I'll just be honest, and I do think our church needs to do a little more thinking about this, a little more theology on it, because it's not simple. There's no simple answer. But the particular passage we heard from John today, I think, points us in a good direction. The primary theme is not that there will be one flock, one shepherd, although that is there, but it's actually a small part of the overall passage. The passage actually asserts that the key characteristic of Jesus is that he lays down his life for the sheep. Any way we think about this, we have to think about it in a self-sacrificial way, in terms of our own willingness to lay down our lives, or even just the convictions that structure our lives. And while this in and of itself doesn't solve our theological dilemma, it can guide us. It can guide us in interfaith conversations. It can even help us in conversations with people who disagree with us or who we disagree with. Basically, it gives us a pretty good rule. We must sacrifice ourselves. We must be the ones to take the first step. And it's a risky step. And it might lead to pain and loss and suffering. We here at Trinity have discerned in a number of different discernment efforts among our commissions and ministries that God is calling us to reach out to differences. I've been really struck as we've done different types of discernment exercises and we keep landing on that. Our commission, for example, our commission on compassion, peace, and reconciliation just prayerfully determined that our work to combat racism should be a multi-faith effort. particularly reaching out to denominations that are very different from us in how they read the Bible, how they do theology. I personally have been meeting and working with Pastor Philip McCullum of the Reformed Presbyterian Church here in town, the Covenanters. They've been here a long time, and they have a very different way of reading the Bible and a very different understanding about what the Bible is teaching us. But we've just been meeting and talking and trying to not brush aside our differences, not paper them over, but better understand each other on issues like the ordination of women or the inclusion of openly LGBTQ plus persons. And that conversation is slowly bearing fruit. And we both hope that we'll be able at some point to figure out how to extend it to congregants of both of our churches. And also, the church, Trinity, is working on forums for the fall that will look into ways to bring us into dialogue with even other more conservative Christian denominations. And these conversations are likely to be hard. We may encounter conflict. We may feel attacked or put on a cross or just severely hurt and criticized for our beliefs or who we are. So these conversations will be risky. But when we take that risky step, when we are willing to lay down our lives, or even just the convictions of our lives, to be like Jesus, we are like Jesus. We are his own flock. We are the beloved sheep. And the wolf will not snatch us. And we cannot be scattered.
Please stand as you are able. Let us reaffirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified on the cross of Christ. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son shall be worshipped and glorified, she has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The tomb is empty. The sun has risen.
In glorious praise and thanksgiving for the resurrection, we offer prayers for this planet and our brothers and sisters throughout the world.
God of life, in gratitude and great joy, we praise you for the gift of Christ's resurrection. Let us proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God of hope, We pray that your church, in steadfastness and celebration, may bring the light of Christ into the world. Let the church proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God of wisdom, we pray that all leaders of the world will be guided by justice and peace, respecting the dignity of all people.
We pray for our president and members of Congress and our local leaders, our mayor, members of commissions.
Let the world proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God of creation, we pray for your gift of creation, this earthly home to all your wondrous, life-giving works. May we be inspired to use its resources wisely and always according to your purpose.
We pray for those who take care of the land, those who work to put food on our tables.
Let us pray that we will share the vaccine as far as we can, especially at this time to India.
In thanksgiving, let us proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God of healing, we pray for those who are ill, suffering from despair, anxiety, and hopelessness. We pray for all those who have asked for prayers and those in need of reconciliation and forgiveness. We pray especially for Jonathan, John, Melva, Maggie, Beth, Gloria, Evan, Melissa, Bill, Jane, Marianne, Amos and Comfort, Mary, Ruth, Hugh, Ed, Pam, Tandy and family, and all those affected by COVID-19, and any others we now name. In hope, let us proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God of resurrection, we pray for all those who have died and those who mourn.
We continue to pray for Indianapolis as it grieves, for those who were killed in the FedEx shootings, and for comfort for their families, friends, and neighbors. We also pray for the eternal rest of Katie and Ida, laid to rest yesterday.
In belief,
let us pray for a good policy towards guns. Way too many guns in this country.
In belief of the resurrection, let us proclaim, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
O Lord, your mercy endures forever. Hear the prayers of your people and grant us the strength and the courage to walk in your ways all the days of our lives. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace, 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 guys, peace.
Please be seated. So thank you all for being here today again. It's just really wonderful to see the place slowly grow and come back together. It's really nice. So just a couple things. Please do watch the e-notes. We are going to go to a summer schedule like the ones we have done in the past in mid-May. We'll go down to two services at 8 and 9:30, and the 9:30 will also be live streamed. If we find that we have more demand than we have capacity at our reduced capacity, I'll just add a third service. So have no fear. I hope there'll only be like maybe one Sunday of hiccups. We will also start doing a outdoor service once a month in Winslow Park, like we did at Easter. The first one will be May 9th at 11 a.m. And then we will do it on the last Sunday of each month for June, July, and August. That will include, we will ask you to register mostly so that we can, if rain is impending, we can make a judgment call on Saturday, send out an email and say we're gonna move inside and depending on how many people are registered, do one or two more other services inside. So I'm looking forward to that. It was a lot of fun and enables us to sing. So that will be really cool. Please do also look at these announcements, in particular, the Solidarity Sleep Out Support for our youth group, which will be on April 30th, that will ultimately support the overnight shelter Friends Place for Beacon. And our youth are going to sleep out here in the Brabson courtyard. And Emily assures me that they will not be sleeping on the cold, hard cement, just the cold, hard grass. So you need support them. We're almost up to $1,000 in donations. We're almost there. So go ahead and check out that link. There's also a link on our website. And also, I'm thinking I might be able to add some torches to our crucifer. And so if you are an acolyte and would like to do that again, just keep in mind, watch your stuff. We'll be sending it out to the people who did it before. If you're interested in doing it now, let us know at the office. Let me know, whatever. And we'll get a training and kind of figure out how we're going to do it now. Are there any other announcements? Well, then, as I've been saying, we, out of an abundance of caution, we are not passing the offering plate, but if you would like to make a financial offering in Thanksgiving, along with your offering of praise and Thanksgiving and sacrifice of praise and Thanksgiving, there is a plate there. Feel free to leave something in it. I think the easiest thing is as you leave. So let us ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to you, O Lord, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in the word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you. body of Christ.
Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food and the most precious body of life, the Son of our Savior, Jesus Christ, for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are the members, Father of your Son, and the heirs of eternal kingdom. And our Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do. Concerning you and faithful witnesses, Christ our Lord. To him and to you and to the Holy Spirit, the honor of you. Now pray. Amen. And with our brothers and sisters at home, let us pray the prayer for spiritual communion. Faithful God, in the wonder of your wisdom and love, you fed your people in the wilderness with the bread of angels, and you sent Jesus to be the bread of life. Though we cannot consume these gifts of bread and wine, we thank you that we have received the sacrament of Christ's presence, the forgiveness of sins, and all other benefits of Christ's passion. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may you embody your desire and be renewed for your service. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. May Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us his children through the resurrection of his Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of his blessing. Amen. May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever. Amen. May God, who has brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
us go forth in the name of the risen Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.